We have been having some fun with all the science activities in Ayuka, and we have gone on into the afternoon session where we have a set of talks. But now we have a talk by our assistant director, Mr. Ajit Kemhavi, who will be updating us about the present work in astronomy, as well as some of the great mega projects of astronomy that India especially and Ayuka in particular are part of. So let us welcome on stage Mr. Ajit Kemhavi.
I'm going to be talking to you about mega projects in astronomy. Right, so in astronomy we deal with very large numbers, and then we deal with very big units. So you must have heard today about the quantum and so on. And then when you talk of very small particles, if you take a proton, okay, then you've got a mass of 10 to the minus 24 grams. Right, so so what happens is that now you are going to the other end, where the mass of the sun is actually the unit mass. Right, so what do I mean by that? Because if you if you go to the market and you want to buy potatoes, you won't quote how many potatoes you want in nanograms. Right, so what is a good measure for potato is the kilogram, because you get a bag full of potatoes. So similarly, if I start telling you what the mass of the sun, which is 2 into 10 to the 33 grams, okay, so then you can't even imagine what that is. And you don't need to imagine it. So if I just make the sun standard, okay, then you say that with a star is 5 times the mass of the sun, or 0.5 times the mass of the sun, or 100 times the mass of the sun. So you require natural reasons. But in astronomy, if you try to measure quantities in terms of your everyday units, everything starts to be very large. And so what we, therefore we use astronomical units, and then it starts looking more reasonable. But even then, the universe is so big that in spite of using astronomical units, you still could run into trouble. For example, just like we say that the mass of the sun is a general unit for measuring masses, so similarly, I can take the distance between the Earth and the sun, which happens to be 150 million kilometers. Okay, which means 15 crore kilometers. So then I can use that as a unit. Right, so I can use that as my meter rod, as my unit. And then you will see what is the distance of Mars, what is the distance of Pluto, and so on. But in terms of that unit, if you start measuring the size of the universe, it again becomes incomprehensibly large. Right, so everything that we do there is very large. And then in that sense, when we talk about the new projects in astronomy, you call them as mega projects. Because just like astronomy deals with very large numbers, these projects also, they require a very great deal of effort. They require a lot of time to complete, and they require a lot of money. Okay, so when we are talking about large projects in astronomy, we are talking about the amount of money in US dollars. And you're talking about 1 billion, 2 billion, 5 billion. Okay, so that is a very good deal of money. So I'm going to tell you about these interesting projects because India is now in a very unusual state where several of these projects are being approved. So which means that there's a lot of excitement over the next 10 years. And those people who are sitting in this hall now who are in high school would be doing their PhD by the time these projects come on. And those of you who are at the head of the college or maybe you may be the principal investigators in this project actually getting data from it. Right, so, but in order to understand what these big projects are about, I should first tell you what kind of facilities we have now. Because if you take a small telescope, the kind you can easily buy in a shop, with a lens which is about 1 inch across. And then if you start talking about the 30-meter telescope, then you won't get the scale. So what we want to do is to look at what are the big observing facilities, first in India and then in the world, and then see what I'm talking about when I talk about the projects. So this is a very nice picture of the presently the biggest telescope in India. It has been the biggest, it has been around since the late 1980s. I don't have a picture of the inside. It is called the Venugopal Telescope. It belongs to the Indian Institute of Astrophysics, and it is in Kowloon. Okay, Kowloon is a place which is a very beautiful forest, and that forest will be frequented by this person called Veerappan. Okay, you must have heard of Veerappan, who was finally killed some years ago. And it's a sandalwood forest with a lot of animals. You can buy very fine honey there. And there are elephants, wild elephants, so it's a very exciting kind of place. And there are lots and lots and lots of snakes. Okay, I mean, Ayuka is supposed to have a lot of snakes in it, but this is much more than that. And so here we have cobra, viper, and crane, so be careful. And so then, there's a 2.3 meter, which means that there is a diameter of the mirror, but it is a very massive structure. And if you made a telescope like that now, the Ayuka telescope is 2 meters, it's much smaller in size because of the new technology which is used. Right? So, but here is another interesting telescope, which also belongs to the Indian Institute of Astrophysics, and it is at a place called Hanle in Ladakh. Okay, so at this place is very difficult to approach. You have to first go to Leh and then you have to go to Hanle. The altitude is very high, so you can't just get up and go there, right? Because you need acclimatization. Because you have to be very careful when you go to high altitude. If you are not respectful of it, you can just die. Right? So any number of people who go to the Himalayas and don't respect the mountains, and every year you see dozens of people giving up their life. So why do we put a telescope so far away? It is simply because, first of all, the atmosphere is very clear, okay, and it is very dry, and this telescope can observe at near infrared wavelengths, apart from optical, for which you require a very, very dry place, and at a higher altitude. So then the next question is, if it is so far, and if it is so difficult to get to, how do I observe it? Because when there is a big telescope like this, the way, you can't just say that I want some observations, you need to compete. Because it is very expensive to build such a telescope and to run such a telescope. So the way you compete for that is you write the proposals, and there's a committee of several people. They look at all the proposals, and those which are considered to be good and which are the best among those received get that. Now the point is that this is a radio control telescope. Okay, meaning that there are actually people there on site who will be doing essential things. But the observer, rather than go to Hanle, would go to Bangalore. And then you remote control it with the satellite, and you can just drive the telescope from a distance. You can say, okay, turn here, look at this object for so many minutes. It can all be done. And the data can be downloaded straight from the telescope to the sighting bank. Now, this is our telescope. It's in Giravali, which is about 100 kilometers from here. So it's, Now, it is near a small town called Goregaon. It is also a very nice region. It is less exacting than nobody like Veerappan as far as we know. And then, one day the telescope might disappear. Okay, then maybe there was somebody there. And there are no elephants. Okay, but there are, as you all know, a lot of leopards. Okay, because that whole region where there is this telescope, where there is GMRT, it is a lot of leopards. Right, so this is a picture of the telescope. So you can see it's very difficult to get pictures of the telescope because these are large things. The diameter of the mirror is 2 meters, and then you are inside under very cramped conditions. But this is what you can see. Right, so these three telescopes, and there are one or two others that is smaller than the 1 meter class telescope, but the biggest one in India is going to be at Devasthan. It would belong to ARIES, which is Aryabhatta Research Institute, which is in Naikital. Devaskar is a little bit further away, and you get the most magnificent view of the Himalayas from there. It's again put there because of climatic conditions and so on. It's a 3.6 meters. Okay? At one time, the biggest telescopes were like that. Now, these are 2 meter telescopes which I showed you. They would count as almost small telescopes. 3.6 meters, okay, they are medium sized telescopes. From 2 meter onwards, also with 1 meter telescope, you can carry out a fair amount of research and they can do very good training. These are all optical telescopes, but here is something again which is very famous in Pune, which is a giant meter wave radio telescope in Narayan Gaon. This is the biggest telescope in the world of its kind. Each antenna is 45 meters across. So you say an optical telescope, I've been talking to something with 2 meters across. Then every antenna is 45 meters across, and there are about 30 of them scattered over a very large distance. Okay, so you can say 30 parabolic reflectors. The distance, the baseline is 25 kilometers, meaning that that would be the distance between the furthest telescope. And this is a radio telescope. And radio telescopes have to be very large, because the wavelength of radio radiation is much larger than the wavelength of optical radiation. Right? I'm told you what we have in India, and now we want to go into future science. I mean, what am I talking about? And then I talk about the big thing. What is there? Okay. The thing which is going to go up quite soon is the what I call the near future, that is astrosat. Now, you must have heard about astrosat before. It is the first astronomy satellite, full astronomy satellite, which will be launched from India, completely built in India. And there are small foreign collaborations, and I will talk about this in a moment. When you talk about the next decade begins actually 5 years from now. But here we are talking about well into the next decade, it is nearly 10 years from now. Okay, so then you would have the TMT, which is a 30 meter telescope. Then there is something called LIGO India, which is a gravitational wave observatory. I may tell you a little bit about it. And then you have SKA. SKA is a square kilometer Earth. Okay, so which is going to be the world's biggest telescope. Okay, you see that. You hear me saying all the time, world's biggest, world's biggest. Okay, so it is not that I'm showing up on the behalf of astronomers or behalf of Ayuka or NCI or anything like that. It is that when we want exciting projects now, we really want to do something which has been not done before. Right, so it is possible to use a very small instrument and make something discovery. I mean, Galileo made the greatest discovery in astronomy. Using just a 2-inch telescope which he built himself. Right? So, but you must also remember that at that time, it was the biggest telescope in the world. Right? So if you are only a 2-inch telescope and nothing else, then that is the biggest telescope in the world. And with it, he discovered things which nobody had even dreamt of before. I mean, he looked at the Milky Way, and no one knew what it consisted of, and he saw thousands and thousands of stars there. So what became the greatest thing which became apparent to Galileo's observations with the then biggest telescope in the world is that our world has many things which are unseen. Right? So now, for him it was all dark matter and vision, but it could be seen. So we know that most of the matter in our cosmos is dark matter, and we don't know what the nature is. Right? So therefore there is much, much more which is beyond our normal perception, and that is what we as scientists are trying to understand. Right? So you've got these three big things. But what I would call in the near future, that is 5 years from now. And so there is a mission called Aditya L1. Okay, Aditya means Prasad, as you know. The 12 names, Aditya is one of the 12 names. Okay, and then so this will be launched in about 5 years. It is a satellite which is going to sit at what is known as the Lagrangian, the first Lagrangian point, means between the Earth and the Sun. And there is a point at which the total force due to the gravitational attraction of these two bodies and the force due to the centrifugal because of the rotation, they cancel each other. Okay, so you put a point at L1, it stays at L1. And the importance of putting it at L1 is to because then you can keep seeing the sun all the time on 24/7 basis. So that is what we do. I'm not going to be talking much more about Aditya L1 today. Maybe on another day. Okay, so now here we come to AstroSat. So this is India's first dedicated satellite. Okay, to astronomy. It is being readied for a 2015 launch. Right, so now this extremely important experiment has been sadly out of date, which means that it should have gone easily half a dozen years ago. Now you see that what happens with satellites is that they are very difficult to design, very difficult to build, and then you have got to launch it, at which point there is a risk, and then you put it in orbit. The gestation period of the mission can be quite large. Now, as you might know, the best extra satellites that we have now is a Chandra. It's a satellite. It was actually launched many years ago. It's named after Subramanian Chandrasekhar. And then there is XMS, okay, which is the XMS, the XMS region. And now the point is that this satellite has been there for a while, and a lot of investigations have been done using it. And AstroSat, there is nothing important, and so AstroSat is going to fill the gap between the next big Asian mission and the last big Asian mission. So it is a strategically very important satellite. It has got 5 detectors. Okay, so the and all the payloads have been delivered to ISAT, meaning that the satellite actually gets the ISRO satellite center in Bangalore. Okay, and then they're being integrated onto the satellite, and it's going to be set up in the second half of this year. So the thing about AstroSat is that it has got 5 detectors. Okay, so which I have shown there. And they've got 5 detectors. One is the ultraviolet telescope. The other makes measurements at soft X-rays, and this one is medium, will go to higher energy. So you see that each one of these detectors is pretty large. So you can see here, for example, the ultraviolet imaging telescope. This is the key experiment, which is called LAC PC. So it has got extremely good time resolution. So you can see that building them and putting them together, and you see that these are, it is obvious that these are very delicate instruments. Okay, now imagine putting them on the satellite, and the satellite sits on top of the rocket, and the rocket is very, very tall, and then it just lifts up and goes up. Okay, so when you look at these images of the TV, it appears as if when the flames start coming out from the bottom of the rocket, it rises up slowly. But actually, it is very, very fast. And you are looking at it, in then 1 second, and then just gone. And you see there's a small dot in the sky. So it has got very high acceleration, it vibrates very widely, the temperature will change very much. And all the instruments that you build have got to withstand these extremes. Okay, so they have to be tested for space. It is far more difficult to build these instruments for space than for use on the Earth, or for experiments on the Earth. And so what will AstroSat do? So you see that here this is a spectrum, X-ray spectrum, and this particular thing that you see is with a line from iron. Okay, active galactic nuclei have a fair amount of iron, and iron is a very good fluorescent emitter. Okay, so many of these sources have iron. And the shape of the line, I can tell you about the source that is producing the line and the way this shape is. It appears that the line is coming from a rotating ground. That's a real kind of observation that you can do. And what is most important is what is a timing observation. Okay, because when you've got a black hole, when you've got a neutron star, when matter is polymorphic, the eclipse is taking place, and the emission varies in time. Okay, and if you can find out how it varies in time, get the details of it, okay, then that theory is profound inside. And that is going to be the big thing with AstroSat. What about timing observations? Now, when I come to the other end of the spectrum, you see, I've got a long electromagnetic spectrum, and then at high X-rays, the X-ray photons have high energy. Optical photons are intermediate energy. And at the low end, you have got what is wrong, and the radio photons. Okay, these are the kind of photons which are emitted by the antennae, which transmit sounds to you from FM stations, from within boundary and so on, and if you catch on your antennae or your cell phones, they're all in the radio band of the spectrum. And then the GMRT, as you know, is one of the world's biggest telescopes, which operates at relatively low frequencies. But now, SKA, in which also people who work on the GMRT are making a very important contribution, which is called the square thermal line. So what are you seeing here? You are seeing the positions of where all the activity is. Right? So I told you that the GMRT has about 30 dishes, and the distance, the longest distance between them is 25 kilometers. So now this one is going to be intercontinental. Half of it is going to be in South Africa, half of it is going to be in Australia. And why do you choose these countries? That is because I think the weather, the desert, it's all radio quiet and so forth, because you don't want to be cell phone calls being made and close to the telescope. And it's going to be completed first in 2020 and then we'll go on to 2024. There are 3,000 fish. Each fish is small, much smaller than the real market. But there are going to be 3,000 of them. And you see that it operates on a very wide band. Now these are of course simulations, but there are other telescopes now which are precursors to this which are being used already. And a very interesting aspect of all the new projects, but particularly the scale, is the amount of data which comes out of it. See, the present astronomical data, if you take all the astronomical data in all the astronomical data centers in the world, then it amounts to about 1 petabyte. Okay, so you know how much is 1 gigabyte? 1,000 gigabytes is 1 terabyte, and 1 petabyte is 1,000 terabytes. So it is 10^12 Okay, so that's the amount of data that you have. But what does the SKI will do? It will produce 45 terabytes per second. Okay, and then there will be 500 petabytes coming out of the correlators per year. There is absolutely no way in which currently existing technology can handle this kind of thing. So you see, one of the problems with mega projects is that radio astronomers are designing these radio telescopes which produces so much data that we know that we simply can't handle it. Okay, so therefore, you're going to have to depend upon developments in technology which will catch up with what is required about 10 years from now. So what will happen if you build a telescope and the technology doesn't catch up with you? What will happen to the data? No one knows. But we have a fair amount of confidence in this, okay, that we are going to be able to do it. And that is how you take up the challenge. I mean, if I want to build something which I know for sure will be ready at that time and then I know how to handle the data, then it will be a risk-free kind of issue. Because you are sure that you'll be able to build it. But then it will be a commodity. Okay, it will be building an antenna which I'm going to put on top of my house and catch TV programs. That is not the aim here. What you want to do is to make measurements which no one has done before. Right? And therefore you need to take the risk. The point is that if the government willing to give you money to take the risk. So Allah the Silent Night and Night. That is not the kind of thing the government wants to do. So you see that it is always a tussle between people like us, okay, who think of these big projects and then the government who are supportive of them. But obviously you can't have projects which are too risky and so you have to make it all specific. Right? So that is an art which you learn if you come to this field. Right, so then the next project about which I'm going to be talking for a little while, it wasn't one of the 30 meters. Okay, so this again is not a true picture of it, this is just an artist's impression. But when it gets ready, again in about 2024 or so, it will look like this. Okay, so you see the mirror there, and then you are talking about 30 meters, that is 100 feet from end to end of the hall. Just imagine a lens, a mirror which is as big as that, and that also circular, right? And then the mirror is there, it is not a fixed mirror. Okay, it is going to be floating there on the telescope, and then you have to turn the mirror. Look at that object in that sky. Look at the object there. And then the whole mirror has to turn there. Very precise, very, very precise. And then it has to lock onto the object. Okay, so, and then lock onto the object, why? That is because the Earth is rotating. So if you look at a star, which is there now and it is there later, and so the mirror has to track its rotation. But that is not the end of the problem. Lots of other problems when you build a big mirror like this. It is very expensive. It is going to cost $1.5 billion. Okay, so how much is $1.5 billion? That is 7,500 crores. So that's a lot of money. India is going to pay 10% of that money. But we are not going to send a money order out to them and receive the data. What we are going to do, it's not going to be not even a transfer by next door. Okay? So what we are going to do, is to spend most of that money making parts of the telescope. Okay, and so we don't even have a 10 meter telescope, but this is a 30 meter. But the point is in getting the expertise in certain areas of the telescope technology becoming better than anybody else in the world that needs that. So next time somebody builds a telescope, India, but very well get a contract. Okay, so which means that astronomers like ourselves will be getting the handle on the world's biggest telescope of that time. But at the same time, people who work in the hardware, people who work in the software, everybody would have participated and contributed to the making of the large telescope. You'll be working, we will be working at the edge of the universe, and they'll be working at the edge of technology. Okay, so that is the kind of partnership which is very fruitful, which is very important, and which is why governments are willing to spend so much capital allowing us to make a telescope. It is not a one-dimensional. It is not as if I want to take an image of a particular galaxy, so I throw 7,500 crores. Okay, it is that we really need to do these things in a way which benefits the larger society. So this kind of large project cannot be handled by one institute or one group or one country. So here this is that the US, Canada, Japan, China, and India. Okay, so these are all observatories. These countries are partners. Okay, it is not that the observatories are partners. The countries are partners, and then they're putting on the money. Okay, so but again to understand how big is this telescope, you look at this one, which for a long time was the biggest telescope in the world, okay, which was the Palomar 5 meter telescope. Okay, so it was the mirror is 5 meters. It was built to try to see whether people could make out whether the universe, the cosmos, is open or closed. Okay, so the we have to understand about the structure of the universe with this telescope. It is that it has contributed very greatly to it. And it was the biggest telescope in the world, and then people said that you can't build a bigger telescope like this. Okay, so why can't you build a bigger telescope like this? Because you see that the mirror of the telescope, which as I explained to you, as the telescope turns from one direction to the other, so the mirror must be very rigid. Because as you turn it, there are very small stresses on the mirror, which change the shape by very, very small amounts. Now this change in shape means that the image that you observe is distorted. Okay, to prevent this change in shape, you have to make the mirror thicker and thicker and thicker because it becomes stronger. But as it becomes stronger, it gets heavier. And the idea is that you build a mirror which is bigger than this, it will break up the original weight. Okay, so bigger telescopes are not possible. But clearly, that would be very, very boring, isn't it? Meaning that you build a telescope, the world bigger telescope, you can't build anything bigger than this. But I've got to change the technology and do it. Now we have got 6 meter telescopes, we have got 8 meter telescopes, we have got 10 meter telescopes. And so how did we build that? That is because the mirror is a problem. Okay, so there are two ways in which you can handle it. One way is that you make a mirror which is smaller, which is thinner, which is lighter, but which is strong. And that is because you can discover new materials. Okay, because that is how solid state physicists, material scientists, condensed matter people go on doing the research, and then you learn about this material which is very strong, but it's very thin. But the problem does not end there. I will just look at an 8 meter mirror, or 10 meter mirror, which will be like from there to there. Right? How are you going to transport it? If I build it in my factory, if I observe it in some factory somewhere, industry somewhere, how am I going to transport it? Okay, I mean, you are difficulty enough simply riding on a scooter in a place like Pune. So now just imagine taking a 10 meter mirror. What would be the weight? What would be the size? And that mirror would have to be taken up a mountain and put there. So it is not possible. So therefore, because of all these reasons, and because of the difficulty of making such a large mirror in the first place, scientists will hit upon a new idea, the idea of a segmented. Okay, so there was first tried on this telescope, which is known as a Keck telescope, which is not one, but it has got a twin brother. So there are two identical telescopes which have been made. Each has got a mirror which has got 10 meters in diameter, and you can see the mirror here. Now this is not really, this is a true photograph of it. I mean, these telescopes have been around for about 15 years now, I think. And then you can see the mirror here, which is quite different from what you imagine. You see that it has got these sharp edges. It is not a round mirror which you are used to. Okay, and then here the red thing is a person stretching the arms and sitting. That tells you how big is the telescope. And you see, it is what is known as the segmented inheritance. Okay, the GSMD, giant segmented inheritance. So what does that mean? It means that you take these hexagons, and each one of them is about 1 meter across, more than 1 meter across. You take this hexagon, and then you place them next to each other, and you arrange the whole shape of them, so it becomes one large one. Right? So therefore, what it means is that you can make the hexagons, and you can transport them individually, and then you can take the mirror. And if something goes wrong with one segment, you can just take it off and put on another. So it becomes far more convenient. But then, what is the new problem? I told you that if you have a large mirror, it can get stretched. Okay, as it turns. But even a small, but now there are segmented mirrors. So each mirror itself can get stressed, but on the other hand, the whole shape gets stressed. That's because you're putting them next to each other, and then you have to hold them in that shape. So what is the way that is done is that there are the sensors behind the mirrors, and they go on sensing the shape of the mirror, and that's how they result all the mirrors once every second, and then the computer decides what is the correction to be applied, and then you apply the correction so the shape becomes on. Now this technology is known as active optics. Okay, so it was important to develop active optics before this technology could be so there are 36 hexagons, each of which is 1.8 meters in diameter. Okay, so I told you that the Ayuka telescope is 2 meters in diameter. So it is as if you are taking 36 telescopes and you are controlling. Right? So then you require So here are the telescopes like that. Okay, which is known as the Southern African Large Telescope. It is a 11 meter telescope, but effectively it is 10 meters. It is about 400 kilometers from Cape Town in an extremely remote area. And so this is again a large telescope, the consortium. And Ayuka is a partner in this telescope. So then we own 7% of the shares in this telescope, which means that we also get 7% of the time from this telescope. Okay, so you see that, you see here, this very beautiful mirror, and it looks very nice. That's a real mirror. This is not just an artistic mirror. It's a real mirror. Which is there. You can see the individual segments, and you can see the large structure of the body. So the interesting thing is that if you go to the Ayuka 2-meter telescope, you will find it is really, it looks very huge and large, and it's a very large dome. Okay, so now, so you see, I told you that these are like 30, 40 of those telescopes. But when you go into the dome, you can't figure out the dome is so large. Okay, because there is no scale, there is no comparison. So a 2-meter dome also looks like a 36, 10 meter. It's quite, it's very, very interesting. Here there are 91 hexagons. Okay, so now a very brief interview on what you can see with the telescope. Right, so, and what, where are you going? What would you like to observe? Galileo with the 2-inch telescope observed sunspots, and then he observed the moons of Jupiter. He observed the waxing and waning, the phases of Venus, okay, which helped him decide that the planets are going around the sun rather than everything going around the earth. And then he observed the stars in Venus. So these are fabulous discoveries which are being made. Now, when a modern astronomer gets hold of a very large telescope like this with large instruments, then what do you propose to observe? And what can you do? Okay, so you see that what we are doing, a bigger telescope allows you to observe fainter objects. Right? So that is the whole thing. You want to observe faint objects. Now, objects can be faint because of two reasons. One reason is that there are small objects in our solar system. Right? So why do you want to observe objects in the solar system? Because the small objects can tell us about how the solar system was formed. Are there new undiscovered planets? Are there really small planets? How many comets are there? Where is the cloud of comets? That is one. The other question, the other possibility is the faint object that you are seeing is very far out. And so meaning you take a giant galaxy or you take a quasar and put it at a very large distance from our own galaxy, and then it will be very faint. And what we are interested in is observing those objects. And why are we interested in observing distant objects? That is because the more distant the object, the and the greater, the longer is the time that light has taken come from that object. So which means that a faint object which is very far away is also very cold. So here we are really talking about observing objects which are created quite soon after the universe itself. Okay, that is because then we will know how the universe was when we were very young and what is the origin of this object. So you can see that, you see that here this is a galaxy. I mean, it doesn't look like a galaxy. It just looks like a dot there. That is because it is so far away, it is very far. And you see that again here. So these are kind of very distant objects that you can see. But can we see something? What about excitement? I told you that there could be excitement in our own backyard, in the solar system. But here, let us see what we can discover using the 10-meter telescope in our galaxy. So this is our Milky Way galaxy. It is a near infrared wavelength. It has been taken from our space through multiple exposures. Right? Because you can see the galaxy at night, Akashganga, but from Pune, because the sky is too bright. But if we just go 30, 40, 50 kilometers when the sky is darker, you can see the Akashganga actually has been taken as it has been taken through multiple exposures, and the size of the Milky Way, right, is about 100,000 light years from the right? So if you shine a torch here, by the time the light reaches the other end of the galaxy somewhere here, then it will be 1 lakh years. Okay, so now here at the center you see the big bulb, but what we are interested in is looking at the stars in the center. There are two problems in seeing stars in the center. One problem is that these stars are very far away, and if they are very far away, they will be very faint, number one. Number two is that these brown patches that you see here are dust. Dust absorbs light from the stars, making them even faint. So which means that if you have stars at the center, they will be faint because they are very far away, and they will also be faint because light from them has been absorbed by the dust. Right, so how do we do? How do we find these stars in spite of all that? One is that you use very big telescopes, okay, because they are used to observe faint objects. Secondly, you observe not in visible light, not the kind of light that we see here, but you observe it near infrared light. Okay, near infrared light, it absorbs much less than visible light. So that is where we carry on the observations, which is very difficult to do because technologically I'm doing near infrared observations. And the equipment is very special, and it's very difficult to get time on the last telescope. But if you look at this one here, this is the center of the galaxy. And it has got this rod, the size of this bar here is 6 light months. So I told you that you start with 1 lakh light years, and 1 light year will be 1/1 lakh, and this is half of that. Half of that is this. And then you zoom on it. And then you begin to see the individual stars. And here is what is thought to be the center of the galaxy. Radio astronomers discovered this about 30 years ago. It is known as Sagittarius A. And here are stars which are in the neighborhood of Sagittarius A. It took people 20 years of observations to get here. And what they find is that this single star is two. They looked at the orbit, look at the 1992 and 2002, the star has gone around the galaxy. So this is exactly the kind of thing which Kepler observed in 1610. Okay, so now we are talking about 2015. And what did Kepler observe there? He observed the orbit of Mars, which was an ellipse. And so here this is the orbit of the star S2, is a very beautiful ellipse. And then Kepler gave his law, which can be applied to this ellipse. Therefore, we know that the gravitating center will be sitting at the focus. And using Newton's theory of gravitation, we can determine the mass of this. So the mass comes out to be 4 billion times the mass of the sun, approximately. And this object is so large, so massive, and it is so compact that all the knowledge that we have today of astronomy tells us that it must be a supermassive black hole. Okay, so you see that we use these telescopes and the new technology to find this kind of objects. Like you see, that this was in 1992, 2002, but this was taken in 2009, so you see that the orbit has closed. Then, so we can raise it further, but it's not quite closed. There is a slight non-overlap that you see here. And that is because the supermassive black hole has moved over the small distance. So you see that these distances are very large. The instruments are very large. The time taken is very long to make these observations. But you can take such superfine observations. They move at extremely small distance, but all the calculations and all the things put together can be. Now, when we come to the new technology, here I told you about active optics. Active optics are which are used to make corrections to the shape of the mirror. But there is something called adaptive optics, because this is the image of a star. You have a star you can't see. But there is actually, when you look at a star twinkles. And a star twinkles because the rays of light as they come towards you are continuously deflected by the atmosphere. Because the atmosphere, as the atmosphere becomes hotter and colder, there are small bubbles going around everywhere. The refractive index changes, and therefore the ray of light is reflected. And you can see this here in this time-passage photography here. You see the star jumping around. The net result is a star which will appear like a point source, appears to be large. So now there are two stars close to each other, the binary star which you have studied. But because of the effect of the atmosphere, the stars can be mixed up with each other. And the question is, can we remove the effect of this atmosphere? So that is a technology which is still under development and which is going to adopt the optics. But one straightforward way is that many of you will recognize this as a picture of the Hubble Space Telescope. So what happens is that you take an optical telescope, a 2-meter optical telescope, you put it up on a satellite and you send it outside the Earth atmosphere. There's no terminals, and then you can get beautiful images. Because this is a globular cluster, which is a collection of 100,000 stars. If you look at it from the Earth, then you will just see a big cloud here. You can't see the individual stars. Okay, but once you see this tiny patch here, it is resolved by the Hubble Space Telescope, and each one of these white dots here in the circle is actually a white dwarf. Okay, so you can make these very beautiful observations by going to the outside atmosphere. So if I can put a 2-meter telescope in orbit in there, why can't I put a 10-meter telescope in orbit? The problem is the technology. Because the grain is very large, it is thousands of tons weight for this mirror, and we still don't have launchers to put there. You see that space is very expensive. Okay, so the amount of money which is spent on simply keeping the space telescope in orbit for a year is much more than the amount of money which is required to build a 10-meter telescope. Okay, so we simply don't have the technology. Therefore, what we need to do is to develop the technology that can be used on the Earth and that is known as adaptive optics. So what do you do here? Okay, so you see that this is actually a beam of the Keck telescope, and you see a laser beam going out. So what you do is that you take a very powerful laser and shoot it up to the atmosphere. It's a sodium laser. It goes up to a layer, many kilometers up there, and then you form, you can see a small little thing which can be treated as an ideal star. If you know the ideal star, you know how it is getting distorted by the atmosphere, and that knowledge is used to correct the distortion of real stars. Okay, that technology, you know, the adaptive optics, a massive technology which is here, but the result of that technology is that you see, this is a system here, this appears like one star, okay, and when you apply adaptive optics and correct it, you see that actually there are two stars there. And a further higher technology correction and image processing using resolution gives you this very beautiful image. So you see that the advantage of adaptive optics is that it increases the resolution. The point is that we are going to be spending $1.5 billion to make the KT. And we cannot afford to observe at the limit of the atmosphere. What we need is the adaptive optics to be built into it so that the observations can be made, so you get this thing. So, what does the TMT look like? The 30-meter telescope, so here is a cutout, which is the artist's impression, and then you have got this large mirror here, and then there is a thing which can direct the light from the different instruments. And so, here is the TMT mirror, and it is compared to the Keck mirror, which is the biggest telescope. Now, see how much bigger. This is a 400 that 93 stations, each with 1.5 meters. And the interesting thing that, and this is the mechanism behind each cell segment, you can raise it, lower it, to adjust the shape to do the active operation, which is very common, the active operation. Here is the here is the mountain top on which the telescope is located. It is the Mauna Kea in Hawaii. And this is the, these are the Keck telescope, and somewhere here is one of these is called Subaru, which is a Japanese large telescope. And here, built with the team, a little bit below the summit, but it will be another 10 years until we can take a real view. Now, TMT India, this is a partnership between the Indian Institute of Astrophysics in Bangalore, Ayuka, where we are now at presently, and then ADIS, which is in Medica. And there are lots of university departments and other research institutes like IFR, which are also joining the project. And we will be making many different parts which control the mirror. And then you see that the TMT primary mirror, about 115 segments of the mirror are going to be made. Right? So then India has special strength in software, so much of the software development will also take place. Okay, so now I'm coming to the end of my talk, but I think that I will quickly take you to the another very large project, which is known as LIGO-EDA. Now, astronomy deals with different wavelengths of the electromagnetic radio. I told you optical, which is radio, we are talking of X-ray, we are talking of infrared. But then there is one kind of radiation which is simply nothing to do with electromagnetism. And that is known as gravitational radiation. So let me just show you. Now what happens here is that these are two neutron stars. Neutron stars are very massive objects, about 1.4 times the mass of the sun. But they are very small, they are very compact. Okay, meaning that they are about only 10 kilometers. And the result of these are extremely dense. If you take one spoon of neutron star matter, then you have to weigh as much as all of humanity. Okay, and then they are going around each other. And here's the pair of neutron stars, and one of them is a pulsar. And you know what a pulsar? Pulsar is a rotating neutron star with a strong magnetic field. And it emits a beam of radio radiation, which as the pulsar rotates, just sweeps across you, and therefore you see the pulses. So as the two neutron stars are going round, now let us see what will happen to the two neutron stars. This is a computer simulation. So you see, what will happen is that as the stars are going round, then they gradually move closer, and as they move closer, they merge into each other. And when they merge into each other, they form what is known as a black hole. Okay, because when two neutron stars merge, it is a black hole. Now, this process cannot really be understood in terms of Newton's theory of gravity. But that is because these are very massive objects, very close together. The gravitational field is very, very strong. And therefore, what you require is the theory of the general theory of relativity, which is Einstein's theory of gravitation. So now this here is rather special in two different ways. One is that it is it is 100 years since Einstein first discovered the general theory of relativity. And number one, number two, this is the year of light. Okay, and Einstein's theory also deals with light, so it is a very nice coincidence. So when you consider Einstein's theory, it affects light just like Newton's theory affects particles. Einstein's theory also affects particles, which lead to what is known as the red shift, the blue shift. This is the photons which are going out of a gravitational field. But what happens is that an important prediction of Einstein's theory is that these orbiting neutron stars, for example, would emit what are known as gravitational waves. So now gravitational waves cannot exist within Newton's theory. Okay, so if you had, when you looked at the way electricity was understood 300 years ago, one could not really think of waves at all. But when Maxwell developed the theory of electrodynamics, okay, it became very clear to him that electromagnetic waves must exist. And these waves were soon discovered experimentally. And this was about 150 years ago. Now, everything that we are doing in this call at the present time depends on electromagnetic waves. Because I'm talking and we're going through this microphone, we're going through recommended rates, that's the amplifier there, and all your cell phones, everything is electromagnetic. It depends on electromagnetic waves. Now, Einstein's prediction is that there must be gravitational waves. Now, gravitational waves are far, far weaker than electromagnetic waves, and they are far more difficult to detect. So, if I was able to show you that movie, I would show you a thing where these are, it's exactly the same system. There are two neutron stars which are going around each other and they emit gravitational waves. Okay, now gravitational waves are very special. They are different from electromagnetic waves in the sense that these are actually waves in the these are waves in the space-time structure. Because the theory of relativity equates gravitation with the structure of space-time. So, one of the predictions, then if you look at the system binary pulsar system, before it emits waves, the system is shrinking. And you see the dots are the measured rate at which it is shrinking, and the line is the prediction of Einstein's theory. So, you see that there is a near exact match between theory and prediction, between observation and prediction. But we want to detect gravitational waves. Direct, because they are very important. So the gravitational waves are emitted by all kinds of sources. Here and there, spirally neutron stars. You see the gravitational waves emitted in the early universe, and here the collapsing stars, spinning neutron stars. They are emitted in very different ways, and we want to detect them. So the question is, how do we detect them? The principle again is very simple. It is the principle of what is known as the Michelson interferometer, which some of you might have studied. So you see that this is a gravitational wave which is reaching the Earth. Now suppose there is a ring of particles which is sitting, and then the effect of the gravitational wave is to convert that ring to an ellipse. That's it. You start with a circular ring of particles, it will first get squashed and become an ellipse in this direction, and then it will get squashed in this direction. So first it is a sleeping ellipse, then it is an ellipse. Okay, so now how do I use that? So now supposing that the ring of particles, I got two mirrors here, and there's a laser beam coming in like this, hitting one mirror, it gets displaced, it gets split into two parts and comes down. So when the gravitational wave passes through, instead of a circle, I got an ellipse, which means that this distance is different from this distance. And once that happens, the pattern of light that you see changes. And that is known as a, this whole setup is known as a interferometer. And when you actually convert it to a real installation, you see it becomes very large. So here is a LIGO, that laser interferometric gravitational wave observation. It is nothing for Hanford, which is in Washington State in the US. This pipe is 4 kilometer long, this pipe is 4 kilometer long. It is held at extremely high vacuum. And you can see a close-up of it here. And our next mega project is going to be to build this kind of a detector in India. So where are we going to place it? Why is it important to build it in India? That is because the idea is that you have got 2 detectors in the US and there are smaller detectors in Europe. So imagine putting a detector here in India. Right? So then what will happen when you put a detector in India is that the distance is very long. Because the distance is very long, the baseline is very long. So which means that you can localize objects in the sky very much. So just imagine that you've got a gravitational wave somewhere in the sky. So you will not be able to get its position better than this. But if you put a detector in India, you can see how much the position is. So it's very important to put a detector in India to start a new field which is known as gravitational wave astronomy. So we have made a proposal. We need in group, there are 3 institutes, Institute for Plasma Research in Gandhinagar, and then Raja Ramanna Center for Advanced Technology, which is in Indore, and IUPAC. We together have made a proposal, and the proposal has passed through all stages of approval, and is right now with the Union Cabinet. Okay, so when the Union Cabinet takes a decision, which will happen in about a week's time, then we get an approval for this project. And so this will be mega project in astronomy which does not use light except in the instrument, and this depends upon gravitational wave. So So those of you who are in Pune are very fortunate, because you are young, as you grow up, and you will be neighbors of an institute which is handling all the mega projects which I talked to you about. Because we are making important contributions to ASHRASAT, we are making important contributions to the DMT, to LIDO, and also to ADIT. Okay, so if you want to work on these projects, you don't have to go very far. You just have to take an auto rickshaw and come 3 kilometers. So that is not the kind of activity which many people in the world have. Thank you very much.